that your family has problems, hold on. Consider the marriage mayhem that was created when 76-year-old Bill Baker of London recently wed Edna Harvey. She happened to be his granddaughter's husband's mother. And that's where the confusion began, because according to Baker's granddaughter, Lynn, this is what she said. She said, "My mother-in-law is now my step-grandmother. And my grandfather is now my stepfather-in-law. My mom is my sister-in-law, and my brother is my nephew. But even crazier is that I'm now married to my uncle, and my own children are my cousins." And did y'all follow all that? I'm sure you did it. But all of those relationships could be trickled down from that one very, very strange marriage. And let me tell you something, things can get all twisted up in a family and complicated and confusing in a family. I know that you know all of that. Relationships can get strained, families get broken up, arguments happen, disagreements, misunderstanding, and sometimes it looks like it's just going to die completely. But I've got really good news for you today. Who's ready for some good news? There is hope in Christ. There is hope in God. Nothing is impossible for Him, right? God can untangle any kind of a situation and fix it all up. And I love this verse, Romans chapter 4 and verse 17. I've loved it for many years. I've preached this passage numerous times, and I found it here in this version. I just want to read the latter half of the verse. It says this: God, who gives life to dead people and calls into existence things that don't even exist. Wow, that's your God. Am I right? That's the God that you serve. That's your Jesus. That's your Lord. That's the one that you have a relationship with. That's the God who can raise dead things to life. He speaks and things that aren't even in existence suddenly come into existence. And so if God can do that, there's no family situation that's too hard. There's no marriage situation that's too difficult. God specializes in things that are thought impossible. He specializes in bringing something that's dead to life again, and bringing something that's old and stagnant and causing it to have new life. Last week we looked at four major causes that sink relationships, all right? And today we're going to look at some steps that are necessary to raise those sunken relationships and get things moving. And I'm just declaring that God is going to do miracles and touch people's hearts in a great way. And we know God can do these things, but how many of you realize we've got to be involved? Am I right? I mean, no, we've got to be involved as well. God was able to save Noah and his family, right? God saved Noah and his family. But there were some steps that Noah had to have and he had to do in order for that to happen. He had to build an ark. And this morning, I want to look at six steps that you need today to resurrect a hurting relationship, or even a relationship that seems like it's not going to go anywhere. And there are six steps to this message: A, B, C, D, E, and F. All right. So when things get broken or strained, what do? The first thing is A: you've got to accept responsibility for my part. Accept responsibility for your part. And I know some of you may think, well, Pastor Bob, I can't do that because I'm not the one that, and you can just, whatever, you can fill in the blank. I'm not the one that's the problem. And, it may be that 99.9% of the problem is over there, right? But that means that there's at least some part that we had in it, that 0.1% that we had in it. And I'm going to tell you today that the steps that I'm going to give you today, they're not always the easiest steps, but they are powerful and they will work. But we've got to accept responsibility for our part, right? Am I right? The scripture tells us this, Galatians 6:5, each person must be responsible for himself.
Yes.
We're not responsible for everybody else. I'm not responsible for what my dad does, my sister does, my uncle does, my grandma does, but I am responsible for me. Am I right? You can't control your spouse's actions, their attitudes. You can't cause them to stay in love with you. You couldn't cause them to fall in love with you. You don't have control over that. But the Word of God tells us that we do have control over us, right? We have control over how we respond. We have control over our actions. We have control over what we say to one another. And you can't control what your kids do. Now, we like to think that, right? Especially when they're little, but man, when they get a little bigger, you cannot control what they do. But you can be responsible for yourself. That's a difficult pill to swallow sometimes. The truth is, you can't change anybody else. Right. Oh, that's hard. How many of you like to just be able to change some people, you know? Just fix things up a little bit.
Yes.
You can't do it, but let me tell you what you can do. You can change you, right? And when you change yourself and you start relating to people in a new way and in a different way, actually you can cause them to feel a little bit uncomfortable. It kind of forces them to change. But you start on you, not on them. Am I right? You accept responsibility for your part. Well, you say, well, what does that all mean? First of all, I think it means that, you know, we don't have a pity party about our situation. There's a lot of people that just feel sad. They sit around and they get depressed. They kind of moan and groan and feel bad and get a half a gallon of ice cream and eat that. And that doesn't help. I'm preaching to myself here today, okay? You never stop. And you stop. You know, another thing you need to do is stop comparing, you know, your spouse to somebody else. How many of you know that's really destructive? That doesn't solve anything. That doesn't help. It only makes matters worse. Don't compare your kids with each other. And don't compare your kids with the kids down the block or the other kids in the church or whatever, because that's only going to make matters worse. And, you know, don't compare your marriage. Don't complain about your marriage. Stop resenting your marriage. Am I right? Because if you do that, all you're doing is you're just kind of wasting all this energy. Stop blaming your spouse for your unhappiness. Can I say something? That we're all responsible for our own happiness.
Amen.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Well, my spouse makes me unhappy. Well, why don't you just try to be happy anyway?
Amen.
You might be surprised. They might think, what is going on? Why are they so happy? How did they get all that joy? You know, the truth is, you're as happy as you want to be. Am I right?
Yes.
Nobody else can really make you happy. You got to make yourself happy. And it's your choice to be happy in the ways that you respond to life. It's kind of like God. You're as close to God as you want to be. Because the scripture says that when you draw near to God, what's he do? He draws near to you. So the closer you get to God, the closer he gets to you. And let me tell you something. In the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy. Am I right? You get close enough to the Lord, you start getting joy down in your heart. And that joy will even overcome your happenstance or your happiness. Am I right? You can be as close to God as you want. And that's where real joy, that's where real happiness comes from. So stop blaming your spouse for your unhappiness. Stop daydreaming, fantasizing about what might have been. You can't improve your marriage if you're daydreaming or denying or defending, and you can't fix any of those problems if you're just trying to fix the blame. So you start by accepting responsibility for your part in the situation. And you know, the biggest barrier in accepting responsibility is what I call the myth of incompatibility. Incompatibility, that's a myth. How many of you have ever heard someone say, well, we're just incompatible? I heard somebody say, you know what that really means? He didn't have the income and she wasn't compatible. Incompatibility. No. Actually, there's no such word, right? It doesn't exist. Let me quote you from one of the top psychologists and marriage experts in the world, Dr. Paul Tournier, the Swiss psychiatrist who wrote a book called Understanding Each Other, said this. He said, so-called incompatibility is a myth invented by judges in order to make a plea for divorce. It's like a common excuse for people to hide their failings. Misunderstandings and mistakes can be corrected if there's a willingness to do so. Wow, that's tough, isn't it? And how do you know sometimes it's not incompatibility as much as it is immaturity? Yeah. People don't want to grow up. People sometimes refuse to grow up. And I know that there are many people who have suffered broken relationships in our world today. It's paramount. It's everywhere. It's almost everybody you meet has been bruised and wounded, and they've had difficulty. And I'm in no way diminishing that. And I know that some of you who've been so bruised, have you ever just wanted to tell somebody, why don't you just grow up a little bit? It's time to mature, right? And so sometimes, you know, we've got to make a choice. And you know, there are some people in life that they say, I don't want to grow, right? I don't want to change. I want my way. And that's a choice that some people make. And your spouse may make that choice, but how many of you know we don't have to make that choice? We can decide that we're going to be content in our life with God. We can decide that we're going to be responsible, that we're going to be courageous. You say, well, how do I start this process of accepting responsibility for my part? It might be that you need to write a letter. Sit down and just, you know, I'm not saying make excuses for everything they did. No. I'm not saying just let that go, but at least take responsibility for your part and say, I'm sorry, this is the part that I did wrong, even if it's only 2% of the problem. Go ahead and take responsibility for that. And then once you've done that, decide that you're going to figure out what it is in life that makes you happy and joyful and go after that thing with all your heart. How many of you think we can do that? Amen?
Amen.
We can do that. Amen. And that what that means is you're becoming a mature believer in Christ. Amen. Amen. And then not only do you need to accept your responsibility, my responsibility, I need to accept that, but B.